93 Radio. In the mix.
This episode of Don't Tread on Me is sponsored by Perky's Paperbacks. Check them out.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of Don't Tread on Me. I'm your co-host, Beachball, in for Mad Dog. And I don't know what day it is, according to you, on your particular state's quarantine day. I know we're in day XX because we've been in quarantine so long, I've lost count. People are inside so long, they forget which day it is. Fortunately, I didn't. I remembered it's garbage day, so I got rid of some garbage. Coronavirus is still plaguing the land, although we're hearing some good news, especially out of New York City, which seems to be the epicenter of the pandemic here in America, that the people being reported sick has flattened out. So that is good news. We'll take whatever good news we can during this pandemic. And once again, I'd like to welcome you to Don't Tread on Me, where we discuss current events, politics, and the world of entertainment from a conservative / libertarian point of view. I want to get to talking about the stimulus check that's supposed to go out. And I know a lot of people are very upset with a lot of the pork that was stuffed into it. And if they had taken the pork out instead of $1,200, each of us could have gotten $17,000, which would have been a lot more helpful to the small businesses, I think. But in order to get anything passed in this country, you got to stuff it full of special projects so that everybody votes for it, unfortunately. Now we're hearing that one-third of Americans say that that $1,200 check isn't going to be enough. And from looking at my bills, I could see why. I've already got a $400 water bill. I can't pay it. There's just no way I could pay it. The good thing is at least the city is not going around shutting people's water off because they know how bad it is. So it's starting to get down to the nitty-gritty here. If people aren't already anxious because rent was due on the 1st, then they're certainly anxious the closer and closer we get to the middle of the month. And supplies start dwindling down. I think at the start of the end of this week, I believe on Friday, this weekend, and especially Monday, things are going to ramp up as far as anxiety, crazy stories. I've already seen some crazy stories about people committing suicide because they don't know how to pay the bills. And the best thing that we could do during this crisis is to help each other out, no matter what your political persuasion. As much as we disagree with everything the communists, leftists, and progressives stand for, we still want to help them. We still want to show them that even though we can disagree on everything, even where our rights come from, I'm still going to help you out because suffering is a human condition that we all share, and it's something that I don't want to see anybody suffering through, or their pets, or their children. So if you can, help each other out during this crisis in any way you can, but stay away from each other at the same time. Best thing as the PSA we've been running, thank you very much to Erica for running that PSA and recording it for N3 Radio, is to stay at home, guys. Stay at home. Don't let the virus have a chance to find somebody else to latch on to spread to somebody, especially somebody that is more vulnerable than you. However, we're getting to a point where the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few, and I think the economy needs to be get going here again. I think we need to start, you know, in segments, start putting people back to work. Some non-essential services, and just do it in phases. I think starting sometime at the end of next week, we really need to get that going, because if I'm reading the news correctly, as far as our stimulus checks go, they say sometime during the middle of the month, you know, the 15th. Well, sometime, does that mean that you're going to start delivering them the Monday the 13th or Tuesday the 14th, or are you going to start delivering them after the 15th, the 16th, 17th? Because if people don't get their checks, I think by next week, we're going to start see some flash mob looting, I think. And the longer that this goes on, I think that the greater chance there is for like the summer of 68 or the summer of 69, when it was just, you know, cities were burning, but those were due to race riots, not to food riots. And if a food riot starts at any time during the next month, I don't think the easy victory that Trump had going for him earlier this year is assured, even though the Democrats somehow decided to to run a person even worse than Hillary Clinton, who's been in politics in Washington since he was 29 years old, people. So he's been there for 50 years, basically. The shell formerly known as Joe Biden could possibly win this election if people get anxious enough and don't think Trump is doing a good job. I don't think it's Trump's fault. I think the fault lies specifically with China, because after all, regardless of every single government's job is to make sure it looks good and looks competent. I think the pressure is even more so on a communist government because they have to have total control over their citizens. I hate to, you know, lay blame at a time like this when we need to be pulling together, but the blame is solely on the communist government of China and the state-run media saying, oh, it's not as bad, people aren't dying. If we knew how bad it was, how bad people were dying, how easily or how hard or whatever it could be transmitted from person to person, we would have had a better handle on this, I think. And let's not forget that while Trump was enacting his quote-unquote xenophobic travel ban in late January, he was being impeached. Not saying that the impeachment is an excuse for Trump's response to the coronavirus, but it is a reason. And it's kind of important when you have to set up four different laws to prevent your impeachment, and you're also trying to worry about the coronavirus on the side. Now the funny part, and the best part about this is, everybody is staying at home. They see the lies the media is saying, where they said back then, oh, it's misogynistic, not misogynistic, but xenophobic for you to enact the travel ban. Now they're saying, well, you didn't do enough early. And the man can do no right in their eyes. And plus, you have to remember, the media is chasing that book. The more controversy they generate, the more ad revenue they can generate. They don't care about the news, they care about clicks. If you realize that, realize what the news is, how it's being presented to you, how it's being framed, then you'll get a better idea of what is actually going on. Newspapers is just fiction. On TV, you're getting a portion of the truth, a portion of their truth framed in their light. Even on the conservative side, you're going to get a viewpoint that is slightly skewed. Nobody denies this. But the simple fact of the matter is, and research has shown, that most liberal people will stay and stick with their liberal news and not venture out outside their bubble, whereas conservative people will go outside of their bubble, because we'd like to know what you guys are saying about us, and you guys have no idea what we think, what we do, what we stand for. You have an image in your mind of what we stand for. I'm talking to liberals and leftists here about conservatives. And research has shown liberals, leftists, communists, socialists, whatever you want to call them, have no idea what is really the stance of conservatives, other than the fact they must be misogynistic, racist, hateful people who need to be wiped off the face of the earth. Let's get down to brass tacks. That's what left people think. That's why they try to cancel you. Because they think that your viewpoint is so evil that it cannot be uttered. It cannot be said. That's why free speech and the First Amendment must be taken away, because we can't have this hateful speech broadcast out there for people listening, because the people actually might believe it. And then, of course, you have to take care of the Second Amendment out of that, because the Second Amendment is what gives the First Amendment teeth. All right. Well, let's hop online. Let's start looking at websites and trying to find some news, see what we could find here. Let's go to good old Breitbart and see what the latest news is there coming out from Breitbart. Oh, well, I think we could finally say that the DNC went to Bernie Sanders' house and threatened him with a bat, because Bernie Sanders is out. He has quit the White House race. Path towards victory is virtually impossible. He has suspended his 2020 presidential campaign on Wednesday, paving the way for former Vice President Joe Biden to become the Democratic Party's White House nominee. Basically, they have made sure that the primaries across the country, which are virtually on hold, are going to be attended by the least amount of people possible, because now it's virtually assured that Joe Biden will face off against President Trump in the race for the White House. And like I've heard on so many different sites in the past week, there is no way that Joe Biden is going to debate Donald Trump. Unless the elites can come up with a drug that makes Joe Biden coherent, for 3 hours. There is no way he's going to debate him. He'll come out with a statement saying it is beneath my dignity to debate this monster of a person, blah, 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 blah. So, there you go. Also, we'll see. I love how the media is just trying to just say, you know, Trump is peddling lies at these briefings. We should get these briefings off the air. Yet, you know, if it was a Democrat in office, they'd be cheering on. There's hope. There's hope, hope, hope. They'd be pushing hope because they don't want to make their guy look bad. But since the guy is a Republican in that White House, we got to make him look bad. It is our duty. So there you go again. Media up to its no good tricks. But getting back to Bernie Sanders quitting, I'm not totally surprised by this. I'm a little surprised that it came this early. I thought for sure that he was going to try and do something to get at least people riled up at the convention, which has been moved from July to August in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. But I think this is one of the most stupidest ideas the DNC has come up with in the most recent days. I was going to say ever, but, you know, for the past 4 years, they've just been making fools out of themselves, trying to peddle these conspiracy theories to us, you know. And I really think that the DNC went to Bernie and said, you better get out or we're going to drag your name through the mud, blah, 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 blah. So he said, yeah, I'm going to get out. So how many of you Bernie or busts are going to vote for Joe Biden? How many of you are going to put a Joe Biden bumper sticker on your thing over that Bernie Sanders bumper sticker? How many Bernie Sanders supporters are going to vote Trump just to show their displeasure towards the DNC? I think this all but assured, unless something major happens to the economy, even more so now, or the coronavirus does not go away, we do not start seeing some good news by the end of this month, especially the beginning of May, then we're going to be talking about a very competitive White House race, which I still think Trump can win because, look, you need somebody that knows how to play the media, knows what to say, how to look on camera, know how to lay out their case for the American people. Even if he's doing it for his own ego, he's still doing it for the benefit of America at his own ego, his expense. And that's why I like Trump, because, yeah, Trump's a braggart, he's a bully, but at least I could trust Trump to be a braggart and a bully. I can't trust any of these politicians to do what they actually say, because it just depends on if they're going to get reelected or not. It doesn't matter if it's good for the American people. And that goes for the left and right. Everybody knows it. So, yeah, Bernie Sanders has quit the White House race. Let me go over to a lefty website and see some of the junk they put there. I love going to Salon, because Salon is total trash. And they've got a lot of people that say that we're misogynists and xenophobes, but mostly they actually hate men and white people, mostly over there. So let's see what Salon.com has to say today. Sanders suspends presidential campaign. Trump's surreal bully pulpit. Criminalizing the pandemic won't stop it. Wow. Yeah, there you go. Typical leftist headlines from Salon.com. Of course, Huffington and Puffington Post probably has the same thing. Not Hufflepuff. I'm not talking about Harry Potter. I'm talking about the Huffington Post. There it is. And I'm sure it'll have big headline for Sanders suspends campaign. Let's see what it says here. I also want to go back to this other tab where Breitbart was and see what Fox News has to say as well. And then we'll probably get into some videos here after it says, Socialist surrenders. That's what it says on Fox News. Stocks surge after Bernie Sanders suspends presidential campaign. Can you imagine that? The economy does well when we don't decide to put a communist in office. Imagine that. I can't imagine why. Let's see. Oh, of course, the Dr. WHO hits back. Global Health Org's boss takes cryptic body bag swipe at Trump. Yeah, because that's all you could do is call him names. He took the bait. Just like the liberal media, the WHO director took the bait. The head of the World Health Organization took aim at President Trump's criticism of the agency on Wednesday, telling him and other world leaders not to politicize the coronavirus crisis, quote, if you don't want any more body bags, unquote. The same person who politicized the whole thing for China's sake. Wow. The United States and China should come together and fight this dangerous enemy. They should come together to fight it, and the rest of the G20 should come together to fight it. why would we trust you? Why would we trust you? WHO is basically a mouthpiece for the Chinese government. Let's get down to brass tacks. All right. Oh, and now I'm getting... messages about my tweet saying, why would you say reopen America? It's time. I'm sorry. People die. I think the best thing to do during this coronavirus thing is make sure everybody gets it. That way the human body can build up an immune system for it. And people are going to die. People have died before. I'm willing to give, and everybody's like, well, are you willing to give your life? Are you willing to go out there? Yeah, I'm willing to go out there and lose my life if it means somebody else has a better life, if the economy gets reopened. Absolutely. I'd give my life for my fellow man. Wouldn't you? But remember, we're xenophobe and misogynist. We don't like anybody else. We're hateful people. We're not thinking about anybody but ourselves. Remember that. So I'm going to answer this message and try to convince my friend why we should reopen America. In the meantime, let's look at our daily videos that we always look for. Here we go. We already got some nice videos talking about Bernie Sanders dropping out. So let's go ahead and hear a video from Anthony Brian Logan. If you haven't checked out his videos on YouTube, please subscribe and like them. He is a great commentator. I love his stuff. It's about 10 minutes long. This is Anthony Brian Logan talking about Bernie Sanders dropping out of the 2020 presidential race. Keep it tuned right here to N3 Radio's Don't Tread on Me. I'm Beachball29.
If you want to learn more about American liberty through the context of American history, go to my friends over at patriotpost.us, sign up today, and download your free copy of the Patriot's Primer on American Liberty through the link in the description box below. How's everybody doing? My name is Anthony Brian Logan, and today we got to talk about Bernie Sanders dropping out of the 2020 presidential race to make way for Joe Biden to be the 2020 Democratic presidential nominee. Now, if you were to ask me, hey, ABL, are you surprised? Are you shocked? Are you flabbergasted? Are you taken aback that Bernie dropped out? That'd be a great question. And the answer to that would be, no, I'm not shocked at all. I'm not surprised. If I'm surprised at anything, I'm surprised it didn't drop out earlier, because let's be clear, over the past few days, weeks, months, Bernie has not been doing very well in the polls, in the primaries, in public opinion. He's not been doing well at all. He has some pretty decent events with crowd sizes that may have been a little bit more than Joe Biden, but obviously it didn't translate to votes, because ever since South Carolina, where Biden had a really big victory due to the black vote, it's been pretty much all downhill from Bernie. And really, even before that, it wasn't looking too good for Bernie, because in the very first primary in Iowa, if you remember that, Buttigieg won that particular one, and there was no way that Buttigieg was going to be able to win. So it didn't look good for him from the very beginning. There was not a lot of enthusiasm behind Bernie the same way it was back in 2016 when he was facing off against Hillary Clinton. They're pretty much neck and neck, coming in every race like 45, 48, 49, 51. It was really close between the two of them, but obviously she was able to gain a nomination and was ultimately unsuccessful against Donald Trump. Some said that he would have a better chance of winning. I can't tell, because he's not even doing as well as he did in 2016 now. Now, some are going to say there are more candidates, and that's true. But still, the enthusiasm was not really there for Bernie, and ultimately he had to go ahead and drop out, especially right now during this whole virus kerfuffle, because you can't even go out there and campaign. He had been losing steam since South Carolina, and he couldn't make up the slack by campaigning because you can't do anything. Everything's shut down. You can't travel. You can't go outside your house. Past a certain time of night, you got almost martial law happening. I'm exaggerating, but you understand what I'm saying. He could not make up the slack, so the only choice was to go ahead and drop out. Also, indicated that he would go ahead and drop out soon was when he said a few months ago that if they did not get the necessary votes and delegates to reach the automatic nomination qualifier in the Democratic Party, that if Joe Biden got the plurality of the votes, meaning more votes than Bernie, the most out of everybody else, but not the actual required number, he'd go ahead and drop out, which means he would not try to go to the convention and contest it. Because when you go to a contested convention, all the delegates can drop their affiliation, who they were elected to vote for, and vote for whoever they want. And at that particular time, Bernie could have actually won a nomination, even if he didn't win the popular vote in the primary. That didn't happen, of course, and he said, I don't want it to happen. So really, at that point, when he said that, he may as well went ahead and dropped out, because you've conceded victory to the next man. Joe Biden didn't say that. He never came out to say anything like that. He didn't say, well, if Bernie gets the most votes, I'll drop out, you know, because he wants to actually win, or maybe those around him want him to win. And that's a good segue into Joe Biden. This is really a shame that your best people on the Democratic side are a 78-year-old man who had a heart attack in Bernie Sanders, who's now dropped out, and a 77-year-old dementia patient. Okay, let's not sugarcoat it anymore. Let's not play no games. Joe Biden is obviously dealing with cognitive decline. He's struggling to speak in coherent terms. When you hear him talk, even at his house, when you're talking about out on the campaign trail, stressful environment, he's not working. He's not been in government for quite a long time. So what are you really doing at home? Chilling? You're not campaigning. You're not really doing much. Maybe you do some cold calls. What are you really doing? Even though he's in a low stress environment at home quarantining, he can still barely talk. He can still barely string together sentences. So it's like, what's really going on with you? Obviously, there's mental decline. It's really a shame that the best Democratic Party could do is this man who obviously has no business being out there on the campaign trail. But Democrats don't care. Every Democrat almost has come out and supported Joe Biden. I think, what's the man's name from South Carolina? John Lewis, is that his name? He came out and supported Joe Biden. Who else? Kamala Harris came out and supported Joe Biden, although I thought Joe Biden was a racist white man because of his stance on being an anti-busser. Everybody's come out and supported Joe Biden. I think Pocahontas may come out and support Joe Biden. I think she did so kind of loosely, but not all the way here. And ultimately, I would not be surprised if Bernie himself came out and supported Joe Biden. They're putting all their eggs into this man's basket. He can't even carry a cup of water without shaking uncontrollably. That's really a shame that you're doing that to this man, but that's pretty much where we are. The Bernie bros, this is what I want to ask. The Bernie guys, the Bernie bros, Bernie sisters, what are you guys and girls and X, Y, and Z genders going to do now that Bernie is gone? Are you going to go to Joe Biden? Are you going to go to Trump? Or are you going to stay home? If you stay home, that makes it easier for us on the right to win. So if you're going to do that, then hey, congratulations. Shout out to you. You're doing your country a great service by staying at home and not voting for the Democratic person. You're helping us win. If you do vote, are you going to go against all of what Bernie was talking about, all that against Joe Biden? Are you going to go against your whole thing about socialism and communism? Are you going to go against that and then vote for the guy that's like the opposite of the person you were supporting for the past, I don't know how many years? Are you going to do that? If you do so, then, hey, you know, people change. It's kind of weird how you change overnight, but that's fine. People change. The question ultimately is, what are you going to do now that Bernie is gone from the race? And how do you feel about him dropping out? Not even trying, not even attempting to go to any more primaries or doing any kind of more like virtual campaigning, town halls, nothing. That says, oh, okay, I'm done. And what if he supports Joe Biden? How are you going to feel about that? That's going to be the ultimate burn. But don't be surprised if Bernie supports Joe Biden, because remember, Bernie supported Hillary Clinton in 2016. Joe Biden is the same as Hillary Clinton with a lower body count and less brain function. Simple as that. Not trying to make jokes. I'm just being honest. If you laugh, it's not my fault, but I'm being serious. What are you going to do? I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go ahead and vote for the president again, Trump. And those that can't vote for who they want to vote for, I feel sorry. going forward, what will the Democratic Party do? Are they going to have any kind of new young faces in there? I mean, they had some guys and girls in there now that are pretty young and new. Buttigieg was like 35 years old. Andrew Yang and everybody else. You had some diverse, quote unquote, diverse people, some women, you know, all of that, younger people. But yet you still keep having these 70 plus year old white men as the front runner. I don't really understand. What are you going to do to fix the situation with the Democratic presidential nominees not being electable and not being what your party purports itself to be about? I don't really know, but I think I'll leave that right there for now. And what say you? How do you feel about Bernie Sanders dropping out of the race? Do you think it was a good thing? Was it a bad thing? If you're a Bernie bro, what are you going to do now that he's gone? If you are a Trump supporter, how do you feel about this? Do you think it would be easier for Trump to defeat Joe Biden or Bernie? I think it'd be pretty much the same. Some are saying that Bernie would have been a harder match for Trump to defeat. I don't think so, because Bernie's ideas aren't really mainstream. You may see big crowd sizes and whatnot, but the question is, how many of them are traveling from place to place to see Bernie? They're just diehard Bernie fans. How many of them can vote? How many of them will vote? I'm not really sure how many can and will, because he hadn't been doing very well in the primaries, in the actual voting, or in the polls. So crowds may be kind of decent compared to Joe Biden, but where is the, how does that translate into votes? I think it would have been the same thing come general election time. And Joe Biden, it's really unfortunate that he's pretty much a tomato can. He'll get some votes due to just being Joe Biden and being Barack Obama's former vice president. But aside from that, he has nothing. It's going to be a shame. Either way it goes, the debates are going to be interesting. It would have been good with Bernie. It'd be kind of embarrassing with Joe Biden, but it is what it is.
Welcome back to N3 Radio's Don't Tread on Me. I'm your co-host, Beachball29, and getting back into current events, this is the last time I'm going to mention this news, because it's fake. Because most of the time it is fake, because if, like we've said on this show, if Donald Trump came out for oxygen, all the Democrats would hold their breath. So the latest fake news from the New York Times is, you know, Trump holds a stake in hydroxychloroquine drug maker, which is not true. It's absolutely not true. Getting into the story here, it says, claim Donald Trump has a stake in hydroxychloroquine drug maker report. That's the headline across a HuffPost story that goes on to claim that President Donald Trump reportedly owns a stake in a company that produces hydroxychloroquine, the anti-malaria drug that he repeatedly has touted as a coronavirus treatment, even though his experts say there is no strong evidence it works. The report cited by the Huffington Post is from a New York Times story that said, Trump, quote, Trump himself has a small personal financial interest in Sanofi, the French drug maker that makes Plaquenil, the brand name version of hydroxychloroquine. Trump's personal financial interest, however, does not include a stake in Sanofi, and the New York Times did not claim it did. Instead, Trump's financial disclosures show that his three family trusts each had investments in a $10.3 billion Dodge and Cox mutual fund that owns shares in Sanofi, the world's fifth largest drug maker by prescription sales. As of its latest disclosures, those holdings amount to just 3.3% of the fund's holdings. Trump's most recent financial disclosure forms lists holdings in the Dodge and Cox International Fund valued between $1,001 and $15,000. That means Trump holds a maximum stake in the mutual funds of $45,000, giving him an indirect interest in Sanofi of a $1,485 at most. His financial interest in Sanofi, which has a market capitalization of nearly $58 billion, could be as low as $99.10. This was originally reported by independent journalist Mike Cernovich on his website. Cernovich figures are lower because it appears he was calculating the interest of a single trust rather than combining the three trusts as we have here. Then the Trumps say, so Plaquenil, the company's version of the drug, is not material to Sanofi stock. It is generically available, not sold in the United States, and has been around since the 1950s. Trump's indirect interest in Sanofi pales compared with his indirect interest in practically every company in the world through his much larger holdings and basically every big company in the world through broad market index funds. Trump has a small stake in basically every big company you could think of, according to MarketWatch. In each of the trusts, biggest fund holding is just the broader SPDR S&P 500 ETF, in which Trump holds between $200,000 and $450,000, according to his financial disclosure forms. So he's disclosed his finances for all those leftists out there. So you got to put out your IRS forms. I don't have to do anything for you because nothing will satisfy you people. That's what the right has to realize. It doesn't matter how much you placate the left, how much you acquiesce to the left, how much you give in to the demands of the left. It will never be enough. So we should just stop giving in to the left, and they should start giving in to us. It goes on to say, so one could say Trump has $22,000 or so invested in Microsoft and nearly as much in Apple. It would be accurate to claim that Trump has an interest in the prosperity of businesses around the globe, especially American companies, but it is inaccurate to claim he has a particular interest in the bottom line of Sanofi. Like most diversified investors, Trump's stock portfolio benefits when the broad market rises and is not leveraged to the profits of one company. In any case, it is certainly false to claim he directly owns a stake in the French drug maker, but that did not stop the left from calling, we finally got him. This proves it. He's criminal. He wants people to die. He wants people to die in the streets. He wants minorities, blacks, browns, and Democrats to die in the streets. No, it's not that bad. Calm down. Calm your tits down. Take it easy. It's, I don't understand. What kind of world are you in where you think that every single action by Trump is bad, is evil? What kind of world do you live in if you think that people that believe in conservatism are just plain evil? Now, I will not go out and call every single leftist, every single progressive, every single socialist, every single communist evil, because that's their belief system. It's not them. But at the same time, people who believe that we as conservatives or libertarians should be shut out of society, should be shut up online, that's evil. There's no difference between silencing a person you don't agree with and burning a book. There's no difference. All right, so getting into our next video of the day. We'll go to Tim Pool on this next video. A nice long video, always good for me because I don't have to talk as much. Although I do enjoy this format of talking to you and saying what's on my mind. I have half a mind to just let this video run and comment on it afterwards. Or I could break in the middle. Let's just play the video. It's about 22 and a half minutes long, 23 minutes long. So let's get right into it. It's Tim Pool, leftist call for impeaching Trump again over fake news. This is all about the story I just read. Keep it tuned right here to N3 Radios. Don't tread on me. I'm your co-host, Beachball29, in for Mad Dog. We'll be right back after this video from Tim Pool. Don't forget to like and share it.
We got him. We got him. We got the orange man. He's going down this time. This is it. After years of investigations, we finally got him, Donald Trump. He's going to be impeached because Alyssa Milano said throw in the towel if Trump can't be impeached for pushing hydroxychloroquine for personal gain. That's right, everybody. Donald Trump owns the company that makes the... Wait, what was that? He doesn't actually own the company that makes hydroxychloroquine? Well, certainly he's got a bunch of stock in the company. He's a principal shit. He doesn't even own any stock in the company? I thought they said he had to fight... Oh, he's got a mutual fund. Oh, Donald Trump invested in a mutual fund? And the mutual fund owns a tiny fraction of a company that at one point was a principal producer of hydroxychloroquine. So we don't got him. But Alyssa Milano still wants to have the president impeached. I'm just so tired of everything, you know. I'm sitting here thinking like, what's the segment for 1 p.m.? Let's talk about news. You know, Bernie Sanders dropped out. I've got something coming up for that later. And well, they want to impeach Donald Trump again. This time, because he mentioned that other countries were using an antiviral drug to treat a viral infection. Welcome to 2020. You know, there's a funny tweet I want to show you, and then we'll read about Alyssa Milano's stupid tweet and the media's reaction. But take a look at this. I love this. This is a fantastic tweet. David Sutcliffe. Sir, I do not know you, but it's an excellent tweet. He said, remember when everyone knew pro wrestling was fake? And they finally admitted it, and the fans didn't care and continued to watch anyway. We're almost there with politics and the media. Huh. So every day, something comes up where these resistance people are like, we got him! We got him! This is certainly going to bring down the president. It never does, because it's always fake. I feel like the media whips up people like Alyssa Milano into a frenzy over things they know are fake. It's kind of like watching someone dangle keys over a child, you know, and the kid's going like, yay, like, you know, dancing at the keys. You're not going to get the keys. And even if you did, you wouldn't know what to do with them. You have no idea how the keys work. That's what the media does. They dangle keys in front of people like Alyssa Milano. Now, to be fair, I think Alyssa Milano is one of the people who's dangling keys as well. She knows what she's doing. She knows it's not going to happen. But there is some light at the end of the tunnel in that she's telling everyone to give up. Thank you. Please tell them to give up. Throw in the towel if Trump can't be impeached. Well, he can't be because the story's fake. You made it up. And hopefully after this, it's when you do throw in the towel. Man, I'll show you some of the responses to these tweets. And you know, I there's some people that I like I'm going to criticize. But let's read the story. It's from Breitbart. Actress and left-wing activist Alyssa Milano floated a New York Times report that suggests the president is promoting hydroxychloroquine as a potential treatment for the coronavirus for financial gain as grounds for impeachment. There was another tweet from somebody. I don't know who it was, so forgive me for not crediting you. But they said, Trump stands to gain in the area of four figures over his investment in a mutual fund, which holds a stake in, what is it called, like Sanofi or something. He stands to make millions, potentially tens of millions, if the stock market recovers, if people get better. You see how this works? What's Trump's true incentive here? The fact that one of his mutual funds has got like maybe $99 to maybe $1,500 invested indirectly in a company that doesn't even list the hydroxychloroquine as one of its principal, you know, products, as one of its medicines. He could make a couple grand if the company does well. Or how about all of his stocks and all of his mutual funds skyrocketing if people survive? I think I know where the president's financial incentive is. Look, I think the president's trying to deal with this to the best of his ability. I'm not saying he's the best at it, but I think what these people are saying is absolutely psychotic. But I think it's fair to say, even if you thought Trump's motivation was purely cash, the cash incentive is in fixing the economy and getting us through this storm. Then Trump's going to make way more money. Quote, here we go. Here's Alyssa Milano. Everybody loves Alyssa Milano. Trump can make history as the first president to be impeached twice. I mean, if putting lives in danger by pushing a drug for personal gain during a pandemic isn't impeachable, we should just throw in the towel. Thank you. Oh, she doesn't realize what she's saying. You know, she thinks she's saying, certainly we got him this time. Everybody come out. This is it at every turn, every week, every month. You ever see that video compilation where it's like bombshell report, Trump, the walls are closing in. This is the beginning of the end for Trump. It's frustrating, but also kind of cathartic to watch that because they just say it every single time. But Alyssa Milano doesn't realize what she's just said. She said, if you can't impeach Trump for this, we should throw in the towel. OK, excellent. So when this fizzles out and you can't impeach him over it, take her advice, please. And throw in the towel and stop. You know, Bernie Sanders dropped out. So now I'll throw it to Scott Adams, who said Trump is officially running unopposed, which I think is hilarious. But I'll do the Bernie Sanders. I've got a bunch of stuff for the Bernie Sanders segment coming up later. Let's read about this. Milano's declaration follows a Times report on the general divide over the effectiveness of the anti-malaria medicine, hydroxychloroquine, in treating coronavirus patients. President Trump has touted the treatment, which the Times admitted had not been totally unwarranted. Mr. Trump may ultimately be right, and physicians report anecdotal evidence that has provided hope, the Times wrote, before subtly suggesting the president may have ulterior motives. If hydroxychloroquine becomes an accepted treatment, several pharmaceutical companies stand to profit, including shareholders and senior executives with connections to the president. The Times piece states, adding that Trump has a small personal financial interest in Sanofi, the French drug maker that makes Plaquenil, the brand name version of hydroxychloroquine. However, an analysis from MarketWatch found that Trump's stake could be as little as $99, which we read the other day. And why didn't the New York Times say this? The New York Times knew the information they were omitting. It's a lie by omission. So what the New York Times has done, shame on them, by the way, is whipped everyone up into a frenzy, like I said, dangling keys over the little resistance people going, yeah, the keys. And then now you've got one of the little toddlers telling all the other ones, once we get those keys, then we're going to, you know, drive the truck to the moon. And you're like, that's not a thing that's possible. You cannot impeach the president for this. You have no idea what those keys are for, what they do. And not only that, they could be house keys. They probably are. Here's the quote. They say the report doesn't say how small, but it notes that his three family trusts have investments in Dodge and Cox mutual funds. They mention that the holdings of Sanofi is 3.3%. They say it's the largest. That's what the New York Times is like. It's the largest, their largest holding. It's like 3%, dude. Yeah, you make it seem like they've got 90%. MarketWatch also noted, Trump has a small stake in basically every big company you can think of. Breitbart's John Carney also rated the Huffington Post headline, Donald Trump has stake in hydroxychloroquine drugmaker report, as false in a fact check published on Tuesday. Carney explains, the report cited by the Huffington Post is from a New York Times story that said, Trump himself has a small personal financial interest in Sanofi. Trump's personal financial interest, however, does not include a stake in Sanofi, and the New York Times did not claim it did. Instead, Trump's financial disclosures show that his three family trusts each had investments in a $10.3 billion Dodge & Cox mutual fund that owns shares in Sanofi, the world's fifth largest drug maker by prescription sales. As of its latest disclosures, those holdings amount to just 3.3%. Trump's most recent financial disclosure forms list holdings from the Dodge & Cox International Fund valued between $1,000 and $15,000. So we know all this stuff. Another analysis conducted by documentary filmmaker and journalist Mike Cernovich also points to the Times' flawed and misleading reporting. According to Trump, Trump's financial disclosure, he owns between 1,000 and 15,000 of Dodge & Cox fund and has 2.9% of its money in Sanofi. So these are different numbers coming from Trump. But Cernovich says that he owns between $29 and $435. Cernovich has been right about many big breaking stories, so we'll see how these things play out. Here's a quote. I'm trying to save lives, Trump told CNN's Jeremy Dimon on Sunday when grilled on hydroxychloroquine. If it doesn't work, it's nothing lost by doing it. Nothing, he added. While doctors stress that long-term studies are needed, we know all this stuff. We will move on from here. Let me show you this tweet. Lee, I love you, buddy, but you are wrong about this. Lee Camp is a progressive personality comedian, and I think he's generally a good dude. And I'm just going to say, I think he got duped by fake news. He tweeted, remember when Trump told the country hydroxychloroquine might be able to treat coronavirus? Turns out Trump is invested in the company that makes it. That is 100% not true. Trump is not invested in the company that makes it. He holds no stock of this company. A mutual fund is different from holding stock in the company. You can argue technicalities, but Trump personally has no stock as far as these stories are concerned. He is using his position to boost his stocks, which is supposedly illegal. Now, this breaks my heart. Lee, they got you with the fake news. You got to look into this stuff, man, because here's what we end up seeing. So I responded. He has holdings in mutual funds that hold stocks in companies that, you know, produces the brand name version between $99 and $1,500. Here's someone responded, math is so hard for some folks. The money he will make off that stock is so small, most of our multimillionaire Congress wouldn't stop their cars to get out and pick it up if they saw it lying in the street. Some people then point out Rudy Giuliani bought shares in Novartis. These are major, major companies, okay? Someone buying stock in one of the biggest pharmaceuticals in the world is not evidence of wrongdoing. Many people who hold stock and who buy stock have stock in large companies. Now, what would be really damning is if the president personally instructed his staff or whatever to buy some fringe small company. Let's just make up a company. We'll call it a Florbomed. Let's say Trump was like, here's a brand new company that's manufacturing a drug called, you know, Florbitine. And then he started touting the benefits of this drug that no one's ever heard of from a company he just bought. Yet that would be damning. This is not that. These are major corporations like Donald Trump bought, you know, Donald Trump owns a stake in Microsoft. So now Bill Gates leading the effort of the vaccine. It's because Donald Trump owns a stake in Microsoft. How come they don't report that? Same thing. The New York Times could have said Bill Gates has been has been pledging money to help find a vaccine. And we're wondering why he's fighting so hard and why Trump would be so adamant about saving lives with the vaccine. It turns out Donald Trump owns a small stake of Microsoft himself. And if Bill Gates succeeds, it stands to reason the press attention will be very beneficial to Microsoft. And Donald Trump stands to make a substantial sum of money. That's ridiculous. You can make a circuitous, nonsensical statement any direction you want. But you want to see how the media loves going after this stuff? First, I bring you the Grand Politico article. Trump is an authoritarian weak man. That's right. Trump certainly is an authoritarian, but he's weak. He can't get the job done, Politico says. Coronavirus would be the perfect opportunity for an autocrat. Trump isn't taking it. Wouldn't that mean he's not an authoritarian? Maybe y'all should calm down, Politico. Here's what they write. Let's take inventory of what new insights we have learned from the pandemic about President Donald Trump and his leadership character. One could hardly miss how this crisis has fortified one of the two primary pillars of the anti-Trump argument, as advanced by his most ardent detractors. It has been insufficiently noted, however, the degree to which the coronavirus response has weakened the other pillar. The first pillar is that Trump, in the near unanimous view of the opposition, is a terrible person whose terribleness finds expression in terrible policies. He is narcissistic, dismissive of unwelcoming facts, willing to traffic in falsehoods, lacking empathy, erratic in personal matter, and above all, impulsive in judgment. I mean, I actually agree with those two to varying degrees. I mean, I think Trump has some terrible policies, but they don't want to give him credit for the policies that have worked out. I mean, the economy was doing really well up until the coronavirus. He's definitely narcissistic. He's definitely dismissive of unwelcome facts. But I think the real issue is the degree to which people are willing to accept how severe these issues are. I think when I was watching a clip that was taken out of context, Trump was talking about mail-in voting. And then the reporter's like, you voted by mail. And he's like, right, because I was out of state. So I did the certification process and got everything sealed. And we voted because I was out of state. There's a difference between that and doing all mail-in voting where people can be sitting in the living room and just rubber stamping, you know, and filling out these ballots. Well, the media cuts that out of context. That's the issue. So when they say he's dismissive of unwelcoming facts, I'm not sure I trust, for the most part, how the media frames things. Trafficking in falsehoods, yeah, to a certain degree, absolutely. But come on. Obama did, Bush did. This is the thing for me. They're like, Tim, why don't you complain about Trump lying all the time? Oh, Trump certainly lies. He's also unbearably honest about weird things. It's like he says the quiet part loud and the loud part quiet. But is he worse than any other politician who's lied nonstop? Not that I can tell, and not that I can care. You want me to come out and be all shocked that a politician lied? Oh, spare me. Here we go. Impulsive in judgment. Yeah. Okay. Are you following so far? Even a Trump defender could comprehend how Trump's critics would seize on the performance of the past 2 months. Yeah. The second pillar of the anti-Trump case that has wobbled curiously in recent weeks, this president allegedly is not just a near-term menace, but a long-term one, a leader bent on amassing personal power and undermining constitutional democracy in ways that would last beyond his presidency, which under the worst scenarios, he might even try, Vladimir Putin style, to extend illegally if he loses in November. You may have heard me talk about this story before. This is not the story I actually care about. It's the next story I want to show you. I think it's funny that they're actually writing an article saying Trump is too weak to be the autocrat people want him to be. And now we have this from the Huffington Post. It's time to say it. Trump is handling COVID-19 like a dictator. What? They complained he wouldn't use the Defense Production Act. Now the Huffington Post publishes an article calling Trump a dictator. You know what, man? There's no cohesive plan. None of these people have any idea what's going on. And I'll tell you what's really happening. I and my friends are not staunch Trump supporters. We don't go out around with MAGA hats. In fact, we would very much like to not wear them. We don't wave flags. And most of us, we're not interested in even voting for the guy. We'll see how things play out. But we're not insane. So that means when we're looking at reality, we're like, Trump is not that bad. That's about it. I mean, you got to compare him to all these other presidents. You can talk about the individual, you know, the individual policies that he's put in place, the job he's done. We had a great economy. And for a lot of people, that's the most, you know, important part. You got domestic policy, which tended to work out fairly well. When it comes to environmental policy, Trump has been pretty bad. So if you're an environmentalist and you care about this stuff, Trump has pulled back a bunch of regulations and things like that. I haven't pulled up. So, you know, so forgive me if I'm flubbing some details. But he's not been very good. And I know a lot of people who are upset about that. And I think that's fair. You can disagree with the guy on policy, but like calling him a dictator. Come on, man. You know, his foreign policy stuff, I think, is bad. But Obama's was nightmarishly bad. So I'm looking at a guy and I'm like, eh, you know, whatever. Here's the point I'm trying to make. When you live in reality and you actually know what's happening around you, then you're going to look at the president and be like, I'd like to vote for somebody else. Maybe I won't vote. Or maybe you like the president. Maybe you agree. But we have to agree on objective reality. These people don't believe in objective reality. Case in point, two articles, one saying Trump isn't an autocrat, he's too weak, and one saying he is a dictator. And every other instance where a Democrat has demanded Trump invoke federal wartime authority to force companies to mass produce products he wants. So they say, you should go tell these companies they must produce masks. And Trump is like, well, I don't need to force them to do it. They're doing it. Many are volunteering. And they're like, no, you must force them. And Trump says no. So now they're saying he's a dictator. Here we go. Look at this. President Donald Trump is handling the coronavirus more like the world's authoritarian rulers than its democratically elected leaders. Which is it, media? I get it. They're not the same people. Politico and Huffington Post are not the same outlet. But the reason I'm showing you this is because if you're skeptical of media, You'll be dismissive of both of these articles. But if you're someone who just blindly trusts the media, which the left tends to do, then you're gonna be like, Trump is simultaneously a weak, pathetic, you know, non-authoritarian and a dictator at the exact same time, which I can only imagine makes your brain go, because it can't compute both. Not only that, there are gonna be people who only see one or the other story. And they're gonna, and you're gonna get a bunch of people saying, Trump is not strong enough to do this. He's a weak man. And then they're going to come across somebody being like, no, he's not. He's a dictator. No, he's a weak man. You're a Trump supporter. No, you're a Trump supporter. And they're both going to accuse each other of being Trump supporters and then whatever, they'll get into a fight. But this is what the media has been doing for the longest time. Nothing is cohesive. And so if, as I mentioned, you've got people typically on the left who blindly trust mainstream news. How can you live in a world where everything contradicts itself? It makes no sense, right? In February, the Washington Post and USA Today and BuzzFeed all said that COVID was not a big deal. The flu was worse. Then 2 or 3 weeks later, they're all saying Trump is wrong. It's not the flu. It's you know, coronavirus is way worse. How do you live in that reality where you read the news one day, read the news the next day, and they contradict each other and you're like, this makes sense to me? At a certain point, you have to be like, this is nonsensical garbage that I can't read. How do you read, like, you got two articles. One says 1 + 1 = 3. The other says 1 + 1 = 4. And you're like, both must be true. Well, neither are true. So then you end up with people who are conservative. And I think there's an interesting correlation causation thing going on with these polls. Why is it that conservatives are less likely to trust the media? Could it be that if somebody is trusting of the media, they tend to hold liberal views because they just believe whatever the media says? Could it be that someone who is liberal, who starts distrusting the media because they see the holes, then looks for alternative sources, and it turns out those alternative sources tend to be conservative. You'll end up with then people, I know a ton of people who used to be very lefty who are now conservative, and they read mostly conservative news because they just don't trust mainstream press. Look, I just showed you two articles that contradict each other. They don't make any sense. So what are you going to read? You've got to read something that's cohesive and makes sense. Something with an editorial statement or stand or position. So when you look at conservative media, they're certainly conservative. Many of them are very biased for conservative causes, but they tend to be correcting the press all the time. You know, they would call me conservative for the same reason. But it's just that I live in reality. You know, I've been saying for months, Trump is winning, Trump is winning, Trump's polls are up. And guess what? When I did a video saying Donald Trump's approval rating is higher than it's ever been, what happens next? A month later, it's even higher. His fundraising is going up. He's making more money. His approval rating, it's going up. So when I say I see this, it's significant, I was right. It's not because I like him or want to vote for him. It's because I'm telling you what's literally happening. When the coronavirus pandemic breaks out, what does Nancy Pelosi and Adam Schiff want to do? Oversight committees, investigations. Chuck Schumer, and I gave him credit for this, said we need a czar to handle overseas distribution. And that's at least something related to coronavirus. And like I said, I respect him for trying to do something. Just don't think we need it. Because we have Rear Admiral Palauchik, who's in charge of everything. But you got to give him credit for at least trying something, I suppose. You still have a bunch of Democrats who are pushing nonsense. So if you come to my content, for one, yes, I'm biased. I think these people are insane. The media is insane. So definitely I'm going to miss things, not trust things, and I will be biased. But can you blame me? Just because I don't trust Politico or the Huffington Post to certain degrees doesn't mean I support conservative political positions. I'm saying that you lie so much, I have no idea who to believe. But let's throw it back right to the beginning, to good old Alyssa Milano, who has no idea what's really happening in this world. And she thinks Trump literally did this. And so does Lee. Now, Alyssa Milano is a hypocrite. She says, oh, we have to believe women, except Joe Biden. He's innocent. He's a nice guy. She preaches all day and night. You know, with Brett Kavanaugh, it's like, oh, it's not about due process because Brett Kavanaugh is just being job interviewed. He's not going to prison. Now with Joe Biden, he's being job interviewed and they don't want to actually hold him accountable for the accusations against him. It's just complete BS. To Lee's credit, I think Lee is a good dude. I've known him for a while. He's a good dude. He just got roped in by the fake news and that bums me out. So I sent him a message. I think he's well-intentioned and I don't believe him to be a hypocrite like Alyssa Milano is. He's a legit dude. It bums me out to see them being tricked by the press into believing this fake trash. You know, I go through this stuff every day. It's funny when people say, yeah, they accuse me of not doing journalism. It's like, okay, I'll tell you what, buddy. If you read the New York Times and believe everything they say because they're journalists, you've just bought into fake news. When I take that story, look up other information and verify and fact check. Still not perfect. I still miss a ton of things. But it's another layer upon me doing research and trying to fact check these sources. Sorry, I'm doing journalism. But you don't like it because I just discredited your stupid fake news that you're trying to use to impeach the president. I'm talking about Alyssa Milano. She's a hypocrite. And I will say, there's one thing that does make me feel good. Aside from the fact she's telling everyone to throw in the towel, I like that. Please do. Every side of the culture war hates her guts right now because of the Joe Biden thing. You got the progressive left and the right all telling her to STFU. Ah, feels good.
The Jazzlands, only here on N3 Radio. RC brings you the best in past and present jazz music. Live, Wednesday, 6 Pacific, 9 Eastern, only here on N3Radio.com.
Catch a ride on the wave with the best in retro wave music beginning at 11 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Pacific every Wednesday with your host Robert here on N3 Radio and at N3Radio.com.
In the club, rock and roll and bang your head with me. Rock and roll and bang your head with me.
Bang your head. DJ Kenny Starr brings you the best mixes of hip-hop and rap just like back in club. Starting every day live, 12 midnight Eastern, 9 Pacific, only here on NBRadio.com. Tune in.
Bang your head, just bang your head.
I'm in the club rocking out to a guitar.
We at N3 Radio care about our listeners and each and everyone's health and safety. As you may have heard that COVID-19, also known as coronavirus, has been classified as a pandemic. This pandemic, unfortunately, has a large impact in this world, reporting many illnesses and deaths. The novel coronavirus is a new respiratory virus. Symptoms include fever, cough, and shortness of breath, and may appear in as few as 2 days or as long as 14 days after the exposure. Unfortunately, at this time, a vaccine is not available. We highly recommend that you continue to follow up updates on the World Health Organization website, the CDC website, and your local health department. You can prevent the spread by practicing basic protective measures. Wash your hands often with soap and water for at least 20 seconds. If soap and water are not available, use hand sanitizer with 60% or more alcohol content. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth with unwashed hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Cover your cough when you sneeze. Clean and disinfect touched objects and surfaces. And last but not least, stay at home. Stay at home, guys. You can avoid the spread by staying at home and not going anywhere if you don't have to. And at times like this, we need to reflect and take the time to pray for one another.
Welcome back to N3 Radio's Don't Tread on Me. I'm your co-host, Beachball29, in for Mad Dog, and let's leave the world of the coronavirus politics aside and get into the wonderful world of I was about to say Gamergate, but it's actually Comicsgate. And if you don't know what that is, I'm not exactly sure what it is either, but I know enough to let you know that it basically a bunch of SJWs saw the comic book industry, like other male-dominated industries that they've decided to ruin over the years, football, video games, etc. They said they wanted to get rid of the toxic male, just the toxic white males that were basically the comic book industry's customers, and they wanted to rewrite and redo the whole comic book industry, make it for SJWs. Well, as we all know, get woke, go broke, SJWs. They support your agenda on Twitter, but unfortunately Twitter is about only 22% of the country, and of those, 2% constantly tweet, and most of those are liberal lefties with blue check marks next to their name, thanks to the traitors known as Twitter. That's what they do. That's just what they do. So, anyway, getting back to the whole comic book gate, the comic gate thing, we have, of course, Mr. Cates, you know, just calling out the fandom, calling us misogynists, calling us ists and phobes, and then when the industry starts to go under because of the coronavirus, he begs us to come back. So I'm going to let the umbrella guy take over this next video, but he's also got Ethan Van Sciver. It's a video of a video. Does that make sense? It's the umbrella guy doing a video, Ethan Van Sciver, of Cates basically saying, you know, trying to, you know, say truce. And we all know what we do to people that call us ists and phobes and then beg us for mercy, right? That's right. We tell them to go sink. Fuck off. You called us names. You expect us to forget it? No. It doesn't work that way. So here's the umbrella guy talking about Mr. Cates begging for us, his former customers, the ones he called ists and obes, to come back and please buy his comic book. Keep it tuned right here to N3 Radio. Here's the umbrella guy.
So hey there, you wonderful people, you. We are returning to that wonderful world of comic book coverage where last night, Donny Cates, Marvel writer, decided he would call in to Ethan Van Sciver's Caps, our Comic Artist Pro Secret show. This is very telling, too, because Donny Cates has been one of those people that's out there in the front lines denigrating consumers. He wants nicety now, but, you know, of course, it's not reciprocal. These folks, if they don't get what they want, they tell you to F yourself and on, but of course, people need to be nice to them. Let me say this, too, before beginning. You know, Ethan Van Sciver has an Indiegogo right now. It's almost over. If you haven't checked that thing out, it's definitely worth backing. See, before this recent industry calamity, certain comic pros out there believed they should stand on your back. And anyone that disagreed or anyone that didn't walk lockstep with their political and social agenda, they needed to be outcast. Ethan Van Sciver was one of those people that ended up being outcast. And yeah, you know what? It worked out really well for him. So make sure you back this, make sure that those other people know it, and make sure you give a thumbs up to old Donny Cates. So a couple of real quick things before beginning. Now, I normally won't use a clip that's this long, you know, but I asked Ethan Van Sciver if he was down with that. He said, yeah, don't worry about it. So, boom, gonna use it all. Number two on this, too, people present here. You have Ethan Van Sciver, of course, at the top there. You have Cecil Says right there, and you have Dan Frag. If you don't know them, you should definitely check all of them out because they represent great commodities, they have great ideas on stuff, and it's all Comicscape.
Hey, Donny Cates.
Ethan, how you doing, pal?
Good. I'm live right now. Like, people can hear you, so I'm warning you of that right now. Like, I'm actually doing a live stream right now. You want to say hi to Comicscape?
Well, I would prefer if you and I could have a private conversation. I really would.
Well, I can't because I'm having a very public conversation. But if you want to say, hi, Comicscape, they could hear you right now and they'd be very happy. 2,000 people.
So this little dance here, in my opinion, is really insulting. You have 2,000 potential consumers while basically the industry is drowning. And the guy, he won't even say, hi, Comicscape, and he'll do this repeatedly.
Well, I'd like to have a conversation with you.
They get Donnie. Okay. All right, Donnie. I'll call you a little bit later. All right.
No. You understand. This is just, hey, look, I'm not bothered by it. It's just that you kind of sprung it on me is all.
Just say hi, Comicscape. These are fans, Donnie. These are people that buy your book. Say hi, Comicscape.
Well,
why wouldn't you do that?
I got nothing but love for people who want to support good and honest comics. I'll say that.
See, I love the semantics to this, too. When I was called Comicscape, it was by people like Donny Cates, you know, because, hey, I talked about the reality of comics. Now that everything's falling apart, they want your money, but they still want to stick to the narrative that you aren't even worth talking about. Lovely, huh?
Then you love Comicscape. Then you love Comicscape.
You love Comicscape. That's what Comicscape is. We can have a private conversation later, but right now I'm in the middle of a big live stream. I will call you tomorrow.
All right. Well, you know what? Okay. That's fine, man. I mean, you know, when you and I DM'd back and forth, I reached out and I said that I would like to have a private conversation with you. And you agreed, and I thought that that would be the beginnings of some kind of an accord of some sort of a.
Donnie, you are live right now. People can hear you right now. Do you know that? You understand that? I'm warning you now. People can hear you talking right now.
I know.
Okay. All right. So just so you know that, Donnie, we can still have a conversation. I'd be happy to have a conversation with you. It's just that right now is not the best time.
I understand that, but you and I did agree that we were going to have a private conversation.
That's why I'm not talking to you right now, Donnie. I'm on a private conversation. That's the thing. Now is not a good time to do that. So I just wanted to tell you, I will talk to you tomorrow. I'll call you tomorrow. We will have a beautiful summit meeting. It'll be fantastic.
Well, this is the kind of thing that I'm talking about, Ethan. I wanted to have a private conversation with you, man to man.
So this is the most bizarre thing I've ever seen. You know, hey, bud, I don't want you talking here with all these people. I'll call you tomorrow. We can have a beautiful summit. Well, you know, I thought we would have a conversation man to man. So why don't you dump those 2,000 people and come over here? You see that? That is narcissism. That is ego. That's these people thinking that they are still the upper echelon here, and it's not the consumer. That's not how this stuff works. That's why they fail.
You and fucking then, called him,
and then you put me on blast on in front of all this, and
Donnie, you called me. You called me at 1:30 in the morning.
I called you on your private line.
Yes, I know. And I'm live streaming in front of a whole lot of people, Donnie.
Yeah, man.
And all I did was I wanted to say to you, it's okay. I'll talk to you later. I'm busy right now. There's nothing, Donnie, nothing nefarious is happening here. All I wanted you to...
I understand that. I know it's not nefarious. I get it. We're all good. Everything is good here. I'm just saying that a text in front of this saying, like, hey, man, would you be okay with going 2,000 and all that would have been okay. I'm happy to do that in the future. I really am. I promise that.
The chat is literally crying right now. They're very sad that you won't just say hi to Comicsgate.
I will absolutely say hi. I will say hi to anyone who supports comics.
That's Comicsgate.
Hey, look, I'll just say this. And you know what? And I'll just say this. And then Ethan, if I agree to just say this right now, will you agree to have a private conversation with me?
Donnie, I've agreed to have a private conversation with you 100 times. I'd be happy to talk. Okay. Thrilled to talk to you.
All right. Then what I will say publicly here is that I my comments in the past regarding the group that has called themselves Comicsgate, the people that I have lashed out on have been the ones that have been attacking me. And the thing that I was going to tell you on our phone call was that I'm sure of it, that there are many people in the organization that are not that, that are just people who want to make good comics and have peaceful interactions and stuff. And the people that I have lashed out have been probably the vocal minority that have been hateful, that have been, you know, have lashed out. And Lord knows I've had my moments as well, okay? And so,
see, here's the problem. Donnie Cates does this all the time when he thinks he's going to have a problem. And you know what? This has been a problem that has been made manifest for over 2 years now. A person like myself, for example, he decided to belittle and trash me because, hey, I buy comic books, and I think the way that he treats people is absolute trash. So he calls me an ist. He calls me a phobe. He calls me all of these things. And now, though, when they're having problems, he doesn't want me telling 70,000 people, hey, maybe you shouldn't buy this guy's product. Huh. Interesting how that works, right? Maybe you could have done damage 2 years ago before getting into this little brouhaha.
Why wouldn't you want to do this in private? Why? Like, this is the stuff you wanted to say in private. You're now saying it publicly, which is good. I mean, I applaud it. I think it's good that you're saying this stuff.
Because I want to talk to you about it because there's more to it. Okay, but really, what it comes down to is, you know, my wife and I started our video, and we got a lot of hate.
See, that's the thing that these people are starting to understand. The things that they've been trashing, they're not corporations. They're individuals. When they trash my book, they're trashing something that's by me and two other people. When they trash my YouTube channel, that's just me sitting in my home with a microphone. These kind of things that they're complaining about, my wife and all, well, welcome to the club. That's what you folks have been doing forever, or you've been empowering other people that will attack us. And they'll continue to attack us because we have opinions about the very products that we buy. I mean, really, focus on that. We buy your stinking products. We're allowed to have opinions on them.
And all we were trying to do was promote comics that were still available from shops that you could order from. All right, that's all we were trying to do, and it was never supposed to be an attack on anybody or anything like that. And bottom line, dude, I don't want to take money out of anyone's fucking pocket. Like, I don't want to take a job away from anybody. Like, no matter what your book is or what your group is.
So I like showing this picture a lot. Why? Because this is not only Donnie Cates, but this is Tim Doyle. Tim Doyle decided he would try to destroy Ethan Van Sciver's life. He went after diversity in comics by hiring a private investigator to try to ruin him and go after his children. And this guy decided he would threaten us the day before we actually had manifest property damage. And Donnie Cates, of course, when someone brought it up, he decided to block me for it. Fun times, huh? But of course, he's not trying to ruin or defame. He just lets other people get their hands dirty, right?
Don't worry about me, Donnie. It's not about me. You have to understand, Donnie, it's not about me. Okay, it's not about me or any of these creators here. Comicscape's tens of thousands of fans who publicly supported your work before you denounced them 2 years ago. Don't make peace with me. Make peace with them, Donnie, because I'm not going to betray my fans by publicly endorsing your behavior. All of this positivity shit is bullshit. Apologize to the fans who supported you, and you demonize them all when you demonize Comicscape.
Well,
don't worry about me and my career. I'm doing great, Donnie. I'm doing fine.
I'm not talking about you. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about this idea that somehow people have got it into their head that I want everyone to fail and I want everyone to, I'm trying to take money out of people's pockets and stuff, and that's not true. All right. And you and I can have a longer conversation, preferably that you and I can have one-on-one. But man, look, I'm tired of all the fucking hate, of all the hatred and shit. And
we are too.
See, I hope you caught where he was going to pin that on other people that you guys are promoting, you know, saying that you folks are throwing hatred out. When the reality is that people started talking about what the problems were with comic books. For myself, I would cover stock reports. Because of that, I was called an ist. I was called a phobe. People went after my livelihood because of a product that I bought. So forgive me for not wanting to tell people, hey, I want to buy your product, and other people should, because I don't believe that. And if I don't believe that, I'm not going to tell other people to do that either.
Yeah.
And hey, here's the thing. I'm sure that if we all sat down, we'd all agree on more than what we disagree on. You know, and I think there's been too much of a divide and too much of bullshit people talking for us instead of people talking us talking to each other.
See, he still doesn't get this. It's about creators to this guy. It's about himself. We need to sit together. We need to have a round table. The 2,000 plus people that are listening, they're the ones he needs to be addressing, because ultimately they're the ones that were insulted. They're the ones that they drove away and repeatedly said that you're not wanted here. But now suddenly, when they have a crisis, they want it all back. And they think that the figureheads, as they see that, the quote-unquote creators, those people out there, they have control of it. And you know what? No one controls me. No one will tell me what to think. And anyone that has spit in my face will never have me open up my wallet to them again.
Donnie, I will tell you this. I will tell you this. And I want you to put yourself for a minute now. Let's forget about the fans. And you and I are supposed to have a talk. I want you to imagine that the industry that you gave 25 years of your life to simultaneously worked together to convince the general public that you were a Nazi. And I want you to wonder to yourself if you would ever forget that or ever forgive that. Would you do that? I want you to think about what it would be like if leftist media publications on the internet all converged with the help and support of people who you consider to be your peers to convince the general public that you were a bigot, a homophobe, a racist, and a Nazi. Is there any way that you would ever forgive those circumstances?
I can understand where you're coming from. And
right.
I'm serious when I say that. I can see where you're coming from with that. Okay. I've been getting a little bit of that myself, and I can only imagine.
I've been getting a little bit of that too, and therefore you've been getting that because you made comments about things like New Warriors, and you decided to call anyone who didn't like it an ist and a phobe. You decided to go out and to attack shippers, and when it went sideways and someone in Comicsgate stood up for you, you decided to denounce everyone attached to it. That's why you've had problems. It wasn't because people or your peers stood up and caused you problems. It's because you can't keep your yap shut and go out and just do your freaking job.
But seeing as how, and I don't mean this to be an attack. I don't mean this to be any. Again, you called me, and I didn't know there was going to be 2,000 people here.
I did it on accident. I was trying to look at your message to see what it said, and I accidentally hit the phone button and then hung up real quick, like shit. Yeah. I didn't mean to call you back.
That's okay. I'm just saying, like, I wanted to have a one-on-one with you, because I do believe that if you and I could actually have a conversation, that we could come to some sort of accord where we can not hurt each other, and we could figure out. I don't know. That's the conversation, right? And look, you're not going to get this from fucking Scott Snyder. You're not going to get this from anybody else. Like, I'm actually trying to fucking, like, reach out to you here. All right. I'm sure that you and I disagree on a lot. I'm sure that there's a lot that we agree on. And I'd like to have that conversation. And if I'm not being as eloquent as I want to be right now,
not everybody can be as eloquent as me, Donnie. It's elegant. It's charming and humble.
It's because I didn't know that I was about to be live streamed to 2,000 people. But I will say this, and I'm going to let you go, okay? Because I'd like to continue the conversation in private.
Okay.
If that's okay with you.
Absolutely.
I'd like to leave you with this, and in the past, some people, and I'm not accusing you or anyone else, some people have accused me of this being insincere. I wanted to genuinely just, like, leave you guys with, I genuinely hope that, like, you guys are happy and healthy, and, like, even though we disagree on shit, I hope you're in a safe place, and I hope that you're all taking care of each other, and I hope that we come out of this in a world where, I mean, I hope to God in 10 years we can still, you know, it's not Mad Max times, and we can still keep on these arguments, you know? So, I hope that we can at least agree on that.
I don't want to argue with you guys. I want to beat you guys. That's what I want to do. Hey, I want to beat you guys because I don't want to argue.
And you know what?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And with that, I'll tell you what. That goes back to the grand tradition of DC versus Marvel.
No, it actually doesn't. It goes back to the tradition of ousting someone from the industry. Then the person gets together with other folks and they create a viable alternative industry. See, they don't want people talking about their behavior for the last few years. That's what it boils down to. Because we kept receipts. Because you know what? Everything was going to fall apart eventually. So it doesn't come down to Marvel versus DC. Because you know what? Marvel had this problem. DC had this problem. IDW, Image, they all got together and they said, you guys over there, you are a trash fire. You don't matter. But then people like Van Sciver, they make $1 million on a project. Myself, a virtual nobody in the comics game, makes $110,000 on that. And now these people, they see that when they're sitting here wondering what's gone wrong. They're freelancers, but the freelance thing, their name, it does not matter. So yeah. Of course they want peace, and they want to say, ooh, this is healthy competition. It is healthy competition for us, because we are schooling you right now.
You know, that goes back to the professional, like, the distinguished competition kind of shit. Like, but there was a respect there. There was like, hell yeah, I want to beat you. I definitely want to fucking beat you, you know? And I'm into that. But I will say this, man. I will never do anything to try and take food off of anyone's tables.
And therein is the grandest lie or the largest truth. They've either seen you as competition and they've tried to knock you off the board by calling you ists and phobes and Nazis. Or they've spoken their mind and they've tried to harm you through denigration and to say, really, it's okay to go out and to harm that person these days. Either way, you tell me if there's a healthy respect in that, because I'm not seeing it. I'm not seeing it at all.
I will never try and hurt any of your campaigns. I will never try and do any of that. As far as I, like, an ideal scenario that I want is that I'm allowed to do what I do, which doesn't hurt you and doesn't attack you. And you do the same, you know? And if that can't be achievable, then that's okay. And that's a conversation that we can have. Okay. And I'd really rather have it without 2,000 people.
That's right. All right. So I'm going to continue doing what I'm doing, which is to respect my fan base. And I'm going to listen to my fan base. I'm going to listen to my audience. And by doing so, you and I and, you know, Marvel Comics, and anyone else out there who wants to call me a Nazi and call Comicsgate derogatory names are automatically going to lose. Simply by the fact, by virtue of the fact that I am going to stand between them and you is going to make me win. So I don't need to compete against you guys. I'm already winning. The fans are already on my side. And I would recommend to you, Donnie, that don't think about me. Don't give me any thought at all. I would think about your fans that are disappointed in you. I would think about putting politics out of your conversation entirely. This is not an argument that ever needs to happen in comics. What needs to happen is you need to be getting people excited about Venom, about Carnage, whatever it is that you're doing over at Marvel, and then leave everything else alone, because people are going to disagree with you, but people want to love you the way that they love me. People are going to want to love you. So I would recommend that you do that and don't think about Comicsgate. When Comicsgate says something to you, say, hey, Comicsgate, buy my books. And that's all you need to say. Understand?
Well, even I look forward to a continued conversation. I would prefer it in the future. And this is not an attack. If you and I could have a private conversation, But I wish you well, and I sincerely hope that all your projects go well, and I'm sure they will.
All right, pal. All right, you have a good one. See you later.
Donnie Cates, he has learned absolutely nothing from this stuff. He sees Ethan Van Sciver as someone that's basically going to calm the tide when it should have been Donnie Cates doing it. I mean, what they see is Ethan out here, you know, talking to a large assembly, but they miss out on the fact that Ethan Van Sciver, he's talking to 130,000 people. Well, you know what? They did Yellow Flash wrong, too. He's the type of consumer they said they didn't want. He talks to 130,000 people as well. For myself, I talk to 70,000 people. You have people like Nerdrotic that talk to much, much more. Doomcock. I mean, all of these people out here, you should want them as consumers. You should want them on your side. But no, you can't see it that way. The only thing you see is creator to creator, and you don't respect the consumer. And you know what? You'll always fail with that mentality. So anyway, I think I'll end here, but yeah, I mean, you tell me what you think about this stuff. I think that what you're seeing here is desperation because the market is falling apart, and they definitely do not want anyone out there truly calling them out for what they've done, because you know what? It's costing them money, and really, it was them costing them money, not us. We didn't cost them anything. They went out for years and did that. It's just finally catching up with them. But anyway, you tell me what you think. So to close, I want to say thank you for showing up. Thank you for participating. You make these endeavors possible. I end every video saying that because it reminds me who makes this work. And that's a lesson that maybe Donnie Cates and others should have learned a long time ago. I don't want to take up your time and monopolize it either, but I do want to thank you for it. And I want to say, too, if you like this channel, you know what to do, subscription and all of that. And also, again, check out Cyberfrog 2, Wrecked Planet. That stuff, it supports something outside of that that has been standing up for you for a long time. But anyway, again, thank you for showing up and being here. I appreciate you, and until next time.
And thank you very much, Umbrella Guy. That Umbrella Guy for that video. I want to get quickly into the next two videos because I knew that Tim Pool wouldn't disappoint me. He, of course, has this video out about Bernie Sanders quitting the race. I also wanted to get into the video done by Sargon of Akkad. The Thinkery is the channel you want to check out on YouTube about his take on Bernie Sanders quitting as well. So I'm not sure if we're going to get to the end of that, but let's get right into these two videos, and I'm going to call it a day here. You guys have a good day. Take care. Don't forget to like and share this episode on our N3 No Excuses, No Apologies, No Regrets page on Facebook. You could also find us on the Don't Tread on Me at N3 Radio Facebook page. Like and share it. And of course, I'll post this episode to that page tonight on Facebook. Like and share us. Don't forget to check us out on n3radio.com, spreaker.com/user/n3radio, SoundCloud, Tumblr. We even have a YouTube channel, N3 Radio, and we're going to start broadcasting stuff on Twitch as well here pretty soon. All right, guys, have a good one. This is Beachball29 signing off for Don't Tread on Me. Enjoy these two videos by Tim Pool and Sargon of Akkad from the channel The Thinkery. Keep it tuned right here to N3 Radio, The Jazzlands with RC, The Wave with Robert and DJ Kenny Stars. Bang Your Head, coming up next year on N3 Radio.
Bernie Sanders has officially suspended his presidential campaign. And many people saw this coming. I think, to be fair, everybody knew it was coming sooner or later because the math was not on Bernie's side. Now, Bernie's supporters wanted him to hang on to the very last moment in a desperate bid to try and win the Democratic nomination. But the DNC and the establishment are all in for Joe Biden, which everyone basically recognizes as insane, except for a fringe small sect of weird pro-Biden establishment types who seem to think that even though Joe Biden is not all with it, he could stand up to Donald Trump in November. With Bernie Sanders dropping out, Donald Trump is all but ensured a re-election victory. We just saw it, man. Did you see Donald Trump commenting on that Joe Biden tweet? A journalist asked Trump, "How do you feel about this Biden tweet?" And Trump said, "Biden didn't write that." And Biden's not even watching this press briefing. And even if he is, he wouldn't understand it. Bernie and Trump, both of their bases recognize Joe Biden is not a viable option. Which brings me to the main subject of this story. Will Joe Biden actually get support from Bernie Sanders supporters? And the answer is obviously no. Joe Rogan recently said on his podcast he would rather vote for Donald Trump than Joe Biden. Because anyone with two brain cells to rub together knows that Joe Biden isn't functioning anymore. Look, you can be nice to the guy. You can respect the guy for his career. And a lot of the progressives do not. But the guy's just not with it. I've talked about Bernie Sanders' policies. I don't agree, but at least Bernie Sanders can form sentences. I mean, look, you can have a real debate between Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump on trade. Even Donald Trump has expressed in the past, it was a leaked audio, where he said he was concerned about Bernie the most because Bernie talks big on trade. Well, Bernie Sanders made the mistake of trying to pander to many woke activists over the past year and a half or so, which I believe really hurt him. But Joe Biden just is not viable in terms of actually being a president. We'll see how things play out. But the big concern right now is with the more mainstream Bernie Sanders progressives kind of declaring war on the DNC. I mean, they are livid. They are saying, don't vote. I kid you not. Hashtag never Biden. People on Twitter saying, I encourage you not to vote, which is crazy. I mean, vote for somebody, I guess, but you don't have to. But they're absolutely taking the war to the Democratic establishment. Bernie or bust is alive and well. And around 10% of, I believe it was around 10% of Democrats switched for Donald Trump. I'm sorry. That's not the number. It was around 9 to 10 million Democrats voted for Donald Trump in 2016. And it was 12 to 18% of Bernie Sanders supporters who voted for Donald Trump. Like I mentioned with Joe Rogan, I think it's very likely we are going to see some Bernie or bust individuals vote for Trump out of spite. But there's even one small account called Bernie or else. What does that mean? Well, as we've seen in the past, there is a real fear that Bernie Sanders supporters get violent. I mean, there's the DNC is being postponed. We'll see how things play out. But there was a very real fear of rioting. And now you have people act, you know, Bernie Sanders himself had to condemn the violence that had erupted in 2016. But we've already seen it from the Veritas video leak. So we'll go through all of this. Will we see widespread protest violence? I think so. Absolutely. Because I was there at the DNC in 2016. I saw how the left reacted to what Hillary Clinton and the DNC had done to Bernie Sanders. And now here we are. You think Joe Biden is a better bet? I think it's clear to everybody the DNC would rather lose to Trump than let Bernie Sanders win. And while many Trump supporters would probably agree that they would not want Bernie Sanders, how do you think that makes Bernie Sanders supporters feel? That Bernie actually can think straight? And even, look, even if you think he has bad ideas, the dude could actually talk about stuff. Joe Biden is a joke, an absolute joke. It is a practical joke being made upon all of the Bernie supporters. Not only is the DNC saying, you can't win, we won't let you, but we are going to choose the most absurd candidate to smack you down with to make sure you know that we will absolutely burn this to the ground before we let you win. And that's what's happening. Let's read the news. Sanders drops out of the presidential race, and then I'm quickly going to show you all the tweets from the supporters. Before we get started, head over to timcast.com/donate if you'd like to support my work. There are several ways you can give: physical address, there's a PayPal location. But the best thing you can do is just share this video. I'm sure most people will have heard because it's a major national trend, but we're going to talk about Bernie supporters kind of going nuclear on the Democratic Party. So if you want to help support the channel, you can share it, hit the subscribe button, hit that like button, and hit the notification bell if you want to make sure to get videos from me every day. We'll just read a little bit about this from The Hill because I think we get it. Bernie Sanders is out. I'm more interested in what the aftermath is, but The Hill reports. Senator Sanders suspended his presidential bid on Wednesday, ending a campaign that once appeared on track to dominate the Democratic nominating contest, but that quickly lost momentum. Sanders began reevaluating his campaign after a string of primary losses last month. But he continued his push for the nomination for weeks before ultimately telling his staff in a conference call on Wednesday morning that he had decided to drop out of the race. His decision to suspend his campaign effectively paves the way for former Vice President Joe Biden to claim the Democratic presidential nomination, which all but ensures Donald Trump wins re-election. I bring you now to Twitter. Take a look at this. Dem exit is trending. Wow. Democratic Party, the DNC, Biden, Bernie, 1.1 million tweets for Bernie, but Dem exit, only about 9,500. Hey, people are actually talking about quitting the Democratic Party over this. They're going to war. Hey, good for them. Like I said, man, insult to injury. You want to smack Bernie Sanders down? DNC, you want to make sure? You know what they did? They put up Joe Biden of all people. Now that is insult to injury. We can see here, these are just random tweets. This guy says, I am never voting for Biden. Another person says, Trump on Biden. Let's see here. I don't vote for, I can't even read that. I will never support Joe Biden. I have no empathy for Joe Biden. Hashtag never Biden. Hashtag never Biden. Pass it on. These people are not going to vote for Joe Biden. And you know why? Because Joe Biden, first of all, has nothing in agreement with any of these people. What don't the Democrats understand? The progressive wing is not your traditional Democratic Party. They agree on very, very little. Now, Joe Biden has tried to court them with his, you know, open borders policy stances. And I don't mean like complete. I mean, like there are some aspects of his policies proposed that are decently in the open borders spectrum. But it's not enough. You can't win these people over this way. It's all or nothing. And I'll be honest with you. Even Bernie Sanders wasn't enough for them. Bernie's, what was it saying? Not me, us. Many of these people don't necessarily even agree with Bernie on how he behaves. Many are upset that he's continually endorsed or supported the mainstream establishment. And Bernie is just the best that they could get. Trump on Joe Biden. I love this story. It's when he said that Joe Biden couldn't understand what was even going on. It's absolutely incredible. Here's a question. Let me just read what he said. Donald Trump is not responsible for the virus, but he is responsible for failing to prepare. How do you respond? Trump said he didn't write that. That was done by a Democrat operative. He is probably not even watching right now. And if he is, he doesn't understand what he is watching. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Yeah, Trump nuked Biden, but we all get it, man. Even Bernie Sanders supporters understand just how ridiculous it is to try and make Biden the candidate. Here we have this story from Real Clear Politics. Trump wasn't the first to wonder about Biden's mental acuity. Of course he wasn't. So many people were saying the same thing. Well, Donald Trump has responded by calling on Bernie voters, supporters, to go Republican. I'll tell you what. Have you seen where Donald Trump entertained the possibility of Medicare for All? I laughed so hard at this. And the Bernie people, the Bernie populists were laughing too. Not all of them. But Trump said that it's not fair that there are 30 million people uninsured. And there was some hinting at expanding Medicare for all those who are uninsured. Joe Biden, on the other hand, came out hard against it. It's almost like Trump pulled a bait and switch. Yeah, no, I'm opposed to it. Then Biden says, me too. And Trump goes, actually, I'm for it. So you get all these populists who are now looking at Trump confused, like, is he really going to do this? Putting Trump just a little bit to the left of where Biden is on this. Well, Donald Trump tweeted, Bernie Sanders is out. Thank you to Elizabeth Warren. If not for her, Bernie would have won almost every state on Super Tuesday. This ended just like the Democrats and the DNC wanted. Same as the crooked Hillary fiasco. The Bernie people should come to the Republican Party. Trade. Brandon Strock of the Walk Away campaign responding, hey, Bernie supporters, ready to walk away? Yes, because we just saw hashtag Dem exit trending nationally. Blair White says they can come, but they need to leave the communism on the other side. Hear. Jimmy Dore. Jimmy Dore's awesome, by the way. He's a progressive YouTuber, very critical to Democrats. And he tweeted, Trump willing to tell a truth that MSNBC isn't. In response to what Trump said, if not for Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders would have done substantially better. And so listen, man, you're bringing the Trump people and the Bernie people together. Now, you're not going to get them on policy. You're not going to get them on a lot of cultural issues, but you will get them on their hatred for you. So thanks for providing that common enemy. Scott Adams, Dilbert cartoonist and commentator personality, says it's official. Trump is running unopposed. Yeah. Yeah, Scott, you nailed it. Trump is running unopposed. But I got more tweets for you. This one was particularly interesting to me. It's at Bernie or else. I don't know who this person is. I don't know. Some people are accusing them of being a plant or Russian propaganda. No, I believe it. I believe there are many people who believe Bernie or else. They responded to Andrew Yang, who said, Bernie Sanders is an effing hero. Let's come together and beat this guy. Yeah, a bunch of people said that this ain't it, Andrew. You know, I think Yang's a cool guy. Nah, you know, Yang got a ton of progressive supporters because he had that UBI policy, the freedom dividend. Coming out now and saying, get behind Biden. You know what? Look, Biden is a worse candidate than Donald Trump for one reason. Policy does not matter. I don't know how many times I need to say it, but Biden is just not a viable entity. Of course, the Atlantic wrote that. You remember when I talked about that Atlantic article that said Joe Biden just stay alive. Well, Bernie or else has a website. It literally called Bernie or else, not Bernie or bust. They said we've graduated. We're Bernie or else. Or else what? Well, I mean, they might come out and get a little raucous, if you know what I mean. Here's what they write. It was Bernie or bust. Now it's Bernie or else. Establishment Democrats can't defeat Trump without us. 1,992 have pledged their support to vote for the Democratic nominee if it's Bernie Sanders. And there are a bunch of comments from people who have signed this pledge. I can't read them because these people are very angry. But yeah, they exist. It's not the most, it's not a very, very large number, but the sentiment does exist. Kyle Kalinske, famous progressive YouTube personality, responded to Andrew Yang saying no. When Yang said, let's get together and win, he just said straight up no. Greg Hausch, who is a moderately well-known activist associated with the Anonymous movement, tweeted in response to Andrew Yang, wrong way to go with this, Andrew Yang. There is a percentage of the American population large enough to count as real numbers on a national poll that will never be okay with Joe Biden. He is not a good man. If you want Trump out, you're going to have to find a way to reach us. They're not going to be able to. Cigar and Jetty of The Hills Rising tweets, the Democrats under Joe Biden are now the party of left cultural elites, suburbanites, and Wall Street, while conning traditional voting bases into sticking with them. The right now definitively has the opportunity to embrace national populism and cement their power. Imagine what'll happen if Trump convinces his base to compromise on a few things with the progressive left. With a common enemy like the DNC establishment, you might actually see a bunch of people just get on board with Trump. Many, many won't. The overwhelming majority would not. But you heard it from Joe Rogan. Joe Rogan is the canary in the coal mine. Joe Rogan put the final nail in Biden's coffin. This is what CCN writes. Joe Rogan said what many Bernie Sanders supporters are thinking. He won't vote for Joe Biden. He'll probably end up voting for Trump. I love it. This is the best timeline ever. You know, part of me wants to believe in this grand conspiracy. The Democrats secretly do want Trump. That's right. They love the guy. Because how could they make so many mistakes? It's actually mind-blowing to me how terrible they are at what they do. CCN writes, Joe Rogan, who previously backed Bernie Sanders, said Friday he'd vote for Trump over likely Democrat candidate Joe Biden. Joe Rogan recently backed Sanders, said Friday he'd vote for Trump over Biden. While polls still show Biden as the favorite to win, Rogan's support has all but ended Joe Biden's bid for the White House. They mention the Joe Rogan effect. Millions of Americans tune into Rogan's podcast, giving the comedian a huge platform with which to dismantle Biden. His guest during the episode was mathematician and economist Eric Weinstein, who also said he wouldn't vote for Biden, but stopped short of throwing his support behind Trump. This is the important context here. It's not just about Rogan. It's about Eric as well. Famed intellectual dark web name creator. He won't vote for either. This is what you're going to see. The Bernie people are out. They're not going to vote for this guy. But some of them will, which means you're going to end up with two camps. Trump gaining more support and Biden straight up losing massive support. Donald Trump also mentioned, can't see AOC plus three supporting Sleepy Joe. I disagree. I think Ocasio-Cortez will get behind Biden. I really do. She's been trying to play mainstream. Vox writes, Joe Biden will have a very hard time winning over the Bernie sphere. The problem isn't his platform. It's that he's not trusted. Over at the Washington Times, they say, quote, extreme action. Project Veritas unearths more radical Bernie Sanders staffers. Now, this is what gets important. It's the important context. Bernie supporters, you're going to have to bear with me on this one if you're watching, because I know a bunch are going to get mad. They're going to say, we are not violent, you know, all these things. I'll tell you what. We heard it straight from these supporters. You want to pretend like they're talking big. That's fine. But we've seen how some of these people, the Antifa people, go around and get violent. I'm not here to talk about other groups. I'm talking about Bernie Sanders dropping out. And I'm talking about people threatening. I mean, people were saying that they were going to go to Milwaukee and they were going to burn it down. So the DNC is being postponed. We'll see how things go. Joe Biden is saying he wants a virtual DNC or whatever. Fine. We get it, Joe. You're the nominee. But I was there at the DNC in 2016 and I saw these people protest. Did these people go and protest the RNC, the Republican National Convention? Nope. There was a tiny, tiny handful of protesters there, but not really anything interesting. The DNC, however, it was strange to see many of the American left progressives protesting the Democrats because the Democrats had stolen their real opportunity. For the longest time, many of these people are disenfranchised. And now Bernie Sanders comes along and they feel like this is their opportunity to actually get a candidate who would support them. What happens? Hillary Clinton swoops in, steals the show, and people were trying to knock down barriers, jump fences. There were thousands of people there. None of them. Or I should say a very, very tiny, tiny few, a dozen, a couple dozen, at the Republican convention just hanging out. So will they get violent now? I think it's an interesting question. It's a fair point. Considering that we've seen, and not all of them, you know, obviously, I just showed you people like Jimmy Dore and Kyle Kalinske. Of course they're not. Of course, they're you know, regular people who have political opinions and do shows. But there are a lot of people who are far left who have now seen their last opportunity wash away. Project Veritas did a series of exposés. They interviewed Bernie Sanders staffers, and some of them said this might be our last resort. That's exactly how they framed it. Some of them said even if Bernie wins, they may need to take more extreme action. What do you think they're going to do now that Bernie is out? And this is why I think that they're not necessarily here for Bernie. They were willing to accept Bernie Sanders as good enough for now, because Bernie Sanders has absolutely played to the mainstream. And now that Bernie is out, well, I think now we're going to see a real backlash. ABC News says Democratic backlash after Sanders supporters' violence in Nevada. Leaders of the party are speaking out about the violence. This is 2016. You want to pretend like it's not real? I'm sure there are a lot of Bernie supporters who are going to say, no, 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 it's not true. Tim, you're wrong. You're biased. Look, man, I was there in San Jose when they were beating people up outside of Trump, out of a Trump rally. These were Bernie Sanders supporters. Nobody wanted to believe me. They got mad when I said it, when I did. But I tweeted, the people who were there fighting and chasing and hitting people, they were Bernie supporters. And many people said, Tim, how do you know they're Bernie supporters? Were they walking around saying they voted for Bernie? And I was like, yes. Yes, they were walking around saying they were supporting Bernie Sanders. Some were wearing shirts saying Bernie Sanders. Some had signs. And then the crowd got violent. We're spitting on people, hitting people, punching people in the face. It got violent. And since then, we've seen the escalation of Antifa. Many more people joining up and getting violent. And there's a real possibility we see more. Secular Talk, Kyle Kalinske says, if Biden loses, the left will be blamed. If he wins, the left will get zero credit. Because it's an abusive game and you won't be taken seriously until you demand it in clear and inflexible terms. I'm not, you know, Kyle Kalinske brings up a good point. But I'm sure I feel like there's going to be some people who take this as we must make a take a stand no matter what. Kyle's basically making the point that no matter what they do, they're going to lose because the establishment doesn't want them to win. What do you, so if this is the case, maybe I'm misinterpreting what Kyle says, so forgive me if I'm getting it wrong. But what do you think progressives are going to do now that they think there's no hope? Do you think they're just going to be like, okay, I'm done with politics? Or do you think that they're going to now embrace what many others have embraced in the past, getting violent and fighting and demanding revolution? I mean, Bernie called for revolution, right? Do these people no longer want the revolution? They do. And it was just taken from them. So now I can only imagine they're going to be, you know, being backed into a corner. They'll get more aggressive. Let's get real, though. Donald Trump just won. It's over. Don't even bother trying to argue with me about it. Bernie supporters and Trump supporters probably both already acknowledge it is done. It is a done deal. Trump is going to landslide in November for so many different reasons. The economy was doing really, really great up until the pandemic. Even in the pandemic, most people seem to agree and agree with the president, support his actions. And Joe Biden just literally is not a candidate. He's literally nobody. And I do mean it. He doesn't say anything. He's late to the party. He can't speak properly. In fact, the Democrats would do better if they ran a mannequin. Okay, I'm being a bit facetious, but if the Democrats ran somebody who didn't say a single word, that person would probably do better. What's the saying? It's better to remain quiet and appear stupid than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. Joe Biden removes all doubt all day, every day. If Joe Biden just sat there smiling and said, I'm going to win, people would be like, I'll vote for that guy. Instead, he starts talking about nonsense and it's just gibberish. Some of these tweets are hilarious. Many progressives now are tweeting about their perceived Trump debate with Biden. And it's Trump saying, I'm going to do great for this country. It's going to be huge. You're going to love it. And then Joe Biden says, mumble, sure, mumble, reelect Trump, blah, 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 blah. Just gibberish. Just nonsensical gibberish. Here we have a poll. National Review. Americans prefer Trump's leadership to Biden's during coronavirus response. A plurality of Americans prefer the leadership of Trump to that of former Vice President Joe Biden amid the coronavirus pandemic, according to a Politico Morning Consult poll released Wednesday. This just came out. Of all of the days for Bernie Sanders to drop out, Bernie himself is getting a bit, he's getting a little bit of heat, but it's not really bad. People are saying like, thank you for doing what you did, but you should not have dropped out. I also think Bernie shouldn't have dropped out. I'm not saying I like the guy's policies, but I think there's something very, very wrong with this country if we are going to be seeing Donald Trump up against Joe Biden. For the past 4 years, more, 6 years, with Hillary Clinton and now Joe Biden, it's clear that there isn't a Democratic Party. It's just the Republicans at this point. I get it that you've got House Democrats having the majority. But I feel like that was a last ditch effort by some people who are looking for an alternative. But there's no cohesive alternative anymore. There's no viable alternative. You've got Pelosi, Schiff, Nadler, Schumer, just investigation, investigation, investigation. They're not getting anything done. They're not doing anything. Joe Biden is just not a viable candidate. Trump has done things, whether you like it or not, he has done things. And now with the coronavirus, people agree with it. What do the Democrats have to offer? Absolutely nothing. They could have had Bernie Sanders. And I'm not saying Bernie Sanders is perfect. I'm not saying Bernie Sanders' his policies make sense. I personally disagree with him. But think about the options. A Bernie candidate who came out and said, I would like to give Medicare for all. Trump saying, you know, I think it's unfair. Maybe, but it's probably too expensive. Versus Joe Biden. Blah, blah, yada, blah, mumble, mumble, mumble. People might look at Bernie Sanders and say he's wrong. People might look at him and say, I like the idea. That would have been a real candidate. Instead, you are going to get a losing Joe Biden. So we'll see how things end up playing out. But it's clear. I think Bernie Sanders supporters are not done. I think it's not so much about violence or disruption. I think it's about revenge, retribution, whatever you want to call it. The Wall Street Journal says Bernie Sanders' allies aim to keep shaking up the Democratic Party. Supporters of Vermont senator acknowledge he is unlikely to win the presidential nomination, but they say he's no longer just a lone voice. I'm willing to bet that many of these Bernie people and far leftists and progressives, I don't think they're going to be mad at Trump about this. Trump's minding his own business. They don't have to like him. But I think they're going to see the DNC as someone who's personally slighted them. And I think you're going to see a lot of anger directed at them. And that's what we saw in 2016.
It's over. Bernie Sanders has today live streamed on Periscope, that was posted on Twitter, that he is suspending his campaign. Now, this doesn't mean he's actually dropping out. He's going to use the delegates and the social pressure he can muster as leverage to make the Democratic Party do what he wants. But he's not going to campaign anymore because it's obvious that he's lost to a senile old neoliberal boomer. But I have to say, I find it rather ironic, well, that he's saying the exact same thing as Jeremy Corbyn. We won the argument. We've won the ideological battle. We just happened to lose the campaign. Then in what way can you call this a victory? How did you win? If you failed to persuade people of your position, how can you consider yourself the victor even in defeat? This is the problem with socialism. It makes people not understand that victories and defeats happen in reality. Only a lunatic thinks that in defeat that they are the victor. But anyway, remember folks, thank you, the 10 million people who donated to Bernie Sanders' campaign. No refunds. The millionaire socialist has dropped out. He's going back to his mansions. And, you know, he'll be helping with the coronavirus, I'm sure. But man, there's very interesting things afoot, because apparently he was speaking to Obama multiple times in the last few weeks as he determined the future of his campaign. A source familiar with the conversation tells America. Back in February, Sanders told us he and Obama talked on a fairly regular basis. Really gets the noggin jogging, doesn't it? Barack Obama, the president when Joe Biden was vice president, the president who has yet to endorse Joe Biden, incidentally, really makes you think. But man, how's it going over in the Bernie camp? Not well. 7,000 retweets and 32,000 likes. Right. So Bernie dropping out, and this is from a verified checkmark, threatening terrorism. By the way, this is what they're saying that they're going to do. And this is what 30,000 people want to do now, is terrorism. Thanks, Bernie, for fostering a communist revolution that now has got massive blue balls and wants to burn things down. That was productive. That's kinder, gentler politics, isn't it? That's really making the world a better place. Good job. But regarding the Bernie dropout, Bernie should remain on the ballot. You can still vote for him. The only things that's changing are Bernie shifting his focus to more immediate crisis relief work, and he won't encourage people to risk their lives for a vote. Wow, that sounds like cope to me, but I can see a lot of cope coming. I'm actually so upset. Bernie has spent his entire life fighting for equal rights. He deserved this so much more than anywhere else. Well, I guess the American public didn't agree. I cannot believe out of all the talented and diverse candidates we started with, fucking Joe Biden is going to be the Democratic nominee. Ugh. I don't think I've ever been so disappointed in the Democratic Party, and that's saying a lot. Put a pin in that, because we're coming back to that in a minute. Joe Biden is now the US presidential nominee, meaning the Democrats can never again attack the Republicans for choosing a lying, senile, racist, warmongering sex offender.
The resistance have shown themselves to be hypocrites in the most astounding way. Yes, they have. It's just there's a lot of cope on Twitter. And I feel bad for the Bernie bros, man. Like, you weren't going to win. You weren't going to win. There was no way an ancient socialist was going to win this. It just wasn't going to happen. I feel so hopeless and devastated and powerless. Honestly, I'm glad the verified checkmark's having a bad day. Bernie's been fighting his whole life for this, and America couldn't see that compassion. I'm heartbroken. Yeah, but I mean, he was surrounded by Bolsheviks. I mean, actual Bolsheviks who were threatening to burn cities down. I mean, there is something to be said for a man with judgment that poor. Perhaps he shouldn't be allowed near the levers of power. Bernie just dropped out and is already trending as a sign that people actually liked him or talked about him at his age. He still fought for what was right. Thank you, Bernie. It sucks you could never put that passion into changing America. Well, I mean, the Soviet Union isn't really what America should aspire to become. Bernie fans who are threatening to sit out, please, please think about the rest of us. Your political absolutism has tremendous cost and will be borne by people of colour, immigrants, Muslims, women, the poor, and the climate. There are no both sides here, not even close. Please vote. Yeah, you're ranging everyone against the straight white males. And somehow, the straight white males have won. It's amazing. I don't know why you do it, though, because loads of Bernie fans are straight white males. And you know there is going to be a reckoning among them. There is a Never Biden movement that won't vote for Joe Biden. Bernie bros have warned of a massive exodus if the Democrats nominate Joe Biden. Well, here we go. Now's your time to prove that you are telling the truth and to put your money where your mouth is, an exodus from the Democratic Party. This was always on the cards. Everyone knew it. There are loads of Sanders fans who simply will not vote for Joe Biden. In fact, 15% of them plan on voting for Trump if Biden gets the nomination. Imagine losing like 20% of your support overnight. That would suck, especially if, let's be honest, you're not the incumbent president, so you don't have that advantage, and the candidate that you're backing is openly senile, can't finish a sentence, and has Me Too allegation against him, and just is part of the establishment that everyone hated. The old guard that everyone was against originally has failed. Why would you nominate that again? But here we go. The boomers have done it. They've put Biden in the front seat. And Biden, again, on his own live streams, can't finish his own sentences. You can't say, well, this is about pressure or something. I mean, he's an ancient professional politician himself. He should know what to do in public. He should know how to handle himself. And he is basically incoherent at this point. No one thinks that Biden is compos mentis enough to be able to be the president. Trump, I agree, is probably going to savage him when it comes to the debate. And I can't wait. It's going to be literally political theatre. I'm going to have my popcorn. So, oh, God. Well, if I wasn't on a diet where I couldn't have carbs, I would. I'm going to have my, I don't know, hazelnuts or something. But I'm gonna be popping something while I'm watching Trump absolutely savage Biden. And all Biden can do is either give like a Bernie-style talking point, which will sound hollow because Biden's opposed most of what Bernie stands for throughout the duration of his political career, or Trump literally reaming him over the massive flaws that Biden has. Trump is going to be making jokes during these debates and then just saying, well, I mean, before this coronavirus disaster, everything was going amazingly, because I was running the economy really, really well, blah, 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 blah. And as soon as this is over, not only have I handled it perfectly, I'm going to carry on and it's going to be even better than it was before. And what's Joe Biden going to be able to say to that? I mean, that's broadly true, is it not? He's going to be like, well, I mean, you're talking it up. You're really saying it's better than it actually was. It's like, yeah, maybe he is. But it really was not nearly as bad as you guys say it is. Especially when it came to the economic front before getting to the point where we have to have this quarantine and shutdown. And is Joe Biden going to say China? Is he going to point the finger at China, China, China? Because Trump has been doing that for ages. That was one of the core pillars of his 2016 campaign. And it's not like it won't have more weight now, is it? Like, I don't see a path to victory for Biden in this. And I hope that Trump absolutely crushes Biden. I hope this is devastating. Because, again, if there is one thing that Donald Trump stands for, it is patriotism. If there's one thing that I think the West actually needs at the moment, it's a bit of self-reassurance. So, actually, despite the communist propaganda that's been drip-fed into our ears for decades and decades, the West is actually good. Our liberal democracies, capitalism, do actually do good in the world. They have made the world a better place. Don't listen to the communists. Watch us win it. We'll be right back.
N3 Radio is a nonprofit teaching platform for non-professionals. Copyright disclaimer under Section 107 of the Copyright Act of 1976. Louds is made for fair use for purposes such as criticism, comment, news reporting, teaching, scholarship, and research. Fair use is a use permitted by copyright statute that might otherwise be infringing. Nonprofit, educational, professional use tips the balance in favor of fair use.
You shouldn't use my name.
You know what I said? Dodson! Dodson! We've got Dodson here! See, nobody cares. Nice hat.
N3 Radio in the mix.